Good evening, and welcome to the regular scheduled meeting of the Mayor and Borough Council. Tonight is March 16th, 2015. I will now read the Open Public Meetings Act to start tonight's meeting. I hereby announce a request that such be included in the minutes of this meeting, that notice of the time, the place, and date of this meeting has been prominently posted on the bulletin board at Borough Hall, mailed to the Times, the Star Ledger, Courier News, Patch, and the Alternative Press by January 10th, 2015, filed with the Borough Clerk, and mailed to any person requesting the same in accordance with the Open Public Meetings Act. I'd like everyone else here tonight to please stand for our pledge of allegiance. I
pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd ask that you remain standing as we have tonight's invocation read by Mrs. McGovern, our Borough Administrator and a good Irish woman on the day before St. Patty's Day.
Yes. Fully Irish. We stand together this evening as a governing body to fulfill our duties by processing the business of this borough. Lord, we ask you to shower your spirit upon us, to perform these responsibilities with an open mind and heart, to see and acknowledge the needs of Fanwood citizens to enrich their lives, to lead this community with honesty and integrity, to stand and govern with you in this community. Lord, we thank you for these gifts and these blessings.
Can we have a roll call, please, Mrs. McGovern? Kevin Boris?
Yes, here.
Arthur Hugo?
Present.
Tom Kranz?
Here.
Daniel Levine?
Here.
Catherine Mitchell?
Here.
Jack Molina?
Here.
Mayor Mullen?
Here.
I'd like to have a motion to approve several minutes of meetings that the council and mayor had. First one was last month's regular council meeting of February 18th, and then we had an agenda meeting 2 weeks ago on March 2nd, and we had a special meeting on January 1st, 2015.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Great. I'm going to work my way over to the podium right now. Before we get into our regular business, this is the part of the meeting that we do our proclamations and our special awards. And tonight we will honor a man who I have become very fond of over the last decade that I have been here as the mayor. I'd like to call forward Harry McNally, please. When we think on the council about our volunteers of the month, we have a discussion amongst ourselves at our agenda meeting over who we think personifies everything that is good about living in Fanwood, and individuals who value what this community means and choose to live here and choose to plant their roots here and choose to get involved outside of everything else that we do in life, which is to go to work and to raise our families and to pay our bills and to, you know, be good citizens. But it's those individuals that go that little step further here in town that we'd like to take a moment before we get into our business and say thank you. And Harry is one of them. And I got to know Harry as a concerned citizen when we started our redevelopment. And when we did our outreach meetings, you know, Jack Molinar and Kathy was here at the time, and Harry lives right on Second Street, in across the street from the redevelopment area, and he's an engineer by trade, and he was really very concerned about what we were going to do and the impact that that development was going to have on his quality of life. And instead of sort of sitting on the sidelines, Harry chose to get involved. And he attended meetings, and he came to the planning board, and he raised very good questions, and he used his professional expertise to challenge us on things, to make sure that that we were doing what we needed to do. And I always thanked him for that. And I think that's one, that's what is very important about living in a small town, is that you need to step up and you need to come forward if there's something that you don't like and have your governing body respond. But what you may not know about Harry is his dedication to our Fanwood Recycling Center. And he has worked there for a very long time and is the face, is one of several men and women, you know, who really have come to personify everything that is good about protecting our environment, loving Mother Earth, and making sure that we are all good stewards of our environment through our recycling center. And the recycling center is a very unique hybrid here in our community because there's not many of recycling centers in Union County. And it has been a topic of conversation at the council probably for the last year. And, you know, we are working closely with the Recycling Association to understand what the future holds for the Recycling Center, knowing that we need to do the right thing. We need to take care of the world that we live in and make sure that we recycle, just not glass and cans and paper, but all the other things that you guys do over there. So as we were talking about, you know, who we thought would be a really great face of our Volunteer of the Month, Harry, you know, your name came up. And I think in one sense, it's probably long overdue. So really, on behalf of myself and the full entire council and Mrs. McGovern, I wanted to give you something.
Boy, am I excited, too. I've been hoping to get one of these for a long time.
So this is, you know, as we say, this is the jewel. When people look at Fanwood, this is what they see. This is the jewel of our town. And so it is really, really with great honor that we give this to you, and we hope that you hang this someplace nice. And in all the years to come, know that you really have made a difference here in the town that you call home.
I got to find a place in my house. And I can't match that talk, I don't think, except that I want to turn the honor around in a sense. And I told everybody at our Recycling Association meeting when Harold Clark, our president, announced that I was getting the award. Eleanor had let him know, as well as me. And I said that I feel... like I deserve the award, but that everybody deserves the award, and I'm really going to accept it in honor of all the other volunteers. Now, I went to a lot of work today. I have a feeling that our mayor just did this extemporaneously right now. But I went to a lot of work today to write a bunch of words that I'd like to read, and that would be the only time I'll take the meeting.
You
can hold me to that. I mean, in fact, I even thought that the reason you gave me this award is because I haven't been coming to meetings lately.
We've missed you, Harry.
Yeah, well, one of the reasons is because we've been working so hard at the recycling center now that we've secured our contract for the 3-year time, and because we've upgraded our services and tried to streamline some things by not hiring more people and so forth. So if I could just read,
sure.
I'll read and not extemporaneous. Volunteerism is honored for accomplishment, including expected future. I thank everyone for help with this award for me and all everywhere who volunteer for everything. I especially thank my family, including my sigiller, Betty, and her family, and everyone else supporting my life, which includes positive acts of everyone everywhere. Thanks for honor that I accept as an honor for all volunteering and work that everyone does for our town, area, and specifically our recycling center. I feel deserving of this award as I feel representative of all in my town and area, and our communities deserve all the support we can give. regarding everyone's volunteering and recycling of our materials at our Fanwood Recycling Center. Many thousands of people have volunteered. I get very teary, so my nose has the tears in it. Many thousands of people have volunteered for Fanwood and recycling since their starts as ideas in the 1870s for Fanwood and the 1970s for recycling. I'm only following the millions of actions before, during, and in the future, with all of us working for improvements. We have a unique recycling situation and program in Fanwood with a model of community consciousness. We have a unique, we've had over 50 community organizations and over 50 businesses who've donated and benefited from the Fanwood recycling operations since beginning. Every citizen has contributed to and benefited from our developments via many kinds of support and taxation. And our whole earth benefits from our conservation and resource consciousness and activism. Also, as many know, we have arrested citizens and detention students doing community service at our recycling center. While we honor our volunteers, as I'm only one of these thousands, let's remember for Fanwood's Recycling Center that all households and businesses donate time, intelligence, and taxes for its operation and success. That the center's operations on a borough DPW site have always been greatly assisted by DPWs of Fanwood, Scotch Plains, and Union County. The two town DPWs helped build the center's five giant concrete bins that are used for metals and glass. And all three DPWs have helped with paving and other heavy foundations and critical equipment that we use to get more value from plastics that come from our energy oil from underground and underseas, papers that come from trees anywhere in the world, electronics that have noble and heavy metals and toxins, and many other household and business goods and supplies, some quite heavy. And for recyclers who can't come on do-it-yourself when able Wednesdays, that they try to time and coordinate themselves for Saturdays to do our social lineups most efficiently. In regard to what I'm calling social lineups, we continue to look for ways to improve our traffic flow and time usage for recycling by new learning and applications, and we are continually open to suggestions. And I hope that Kathy Mitchell can vouch for that based on what we talked about at our meeting last Tuesday. If anyone would like to talk more about any of this with me, they are of course welcome, and I try to give most valuable replies to any question or comment. And come see me almost anytime Wednesdays at the center, especially in the plastics area. So I want to thank again Mayor Moore, because I'm sure she remembers some other little anecdotes about my fondness for town parenting, I'll call it, keep out the sexism, rather than town fathers, in other words, and for railroading, because she heard the story of my little boy connection with my little town and my father running the railroad through that town. Then he moved on, incidentally, to be the chief engineer for the construction of the new Penn Station and Madison Square Garden. Well, also tearing down the old Penn Station, which nobody liked. But But it's been a great thing for our area to have it done. So I think there's some redeeming value anyway there. Okay?
Thank you. Harry has also been a really great partner for me because he attends the Raritan Valley Rail Coalition meetings because of his background in railroads, and he understands the long fight that we have had to institute the one-seat rides. And while we've made some headway in off-peak and evenings, I don't want to underestimate that the real work has really yet to begun, because we want the weekends and ultimately the peak hours, and that's really where the fight's going to happen, with actually trying to figure out how to get those time slots in the morning and on the weekends opened up for the Raritan Valley Line. So I look forward to working with Harry from there.
They say they need the new tunnel.
I know. We won't go there. This time of year also, besides being St. Patrick's Day, is another celebration of girls who wear green, and it is actually Girl Scout Week. And we know that because I think all of us know a brownie or a Girl Scout that is selling cookies somewhere throughout our community. And I'd like to call up the Girl Scouts that are here tonight from Troop 40274 and 40220, Bridget and Aubrey and Katie, if they want to come forward. And I have a proclamation here. I have a proclamation here which I'll read first, and then I know that you guys have something that you would want to share with us. So this is Girl Scout Week, which is March 8th to the 14th. And whereas this week marks Girl Scout Week as designated by Girl Scouts of the USA, founded in 1912 by Juliet Gordon in Savannah, Georgia, and where the mission for the Girl Scouts is to build girls of courage, confidence, and character who make the world a better place through honesty, fairness, compassion, and sisterhood. And throughout this long and distinguished history, Girl Scouts, they've built strong character and skills for success in the rural world. And Girl Scouts grow up, they gain confidence, and they develop the leadership skills, and they learn lifelong lessons. And this Girl Scouts help achieve their potential. So whereas the Girl Scouts of Washington Rock was formed in 1957 and has capably delivered the optimal Girl Scout appearance to over 750,000 young women in Union, Middlesex, and Somerset County. Now therefore, I, Colleen Marr, the Borough Council here, do proclaim March 8th to the 14th Girl Scout Week. Congratulations.
Thank you. March 12th, which was last Thursday, is Girl Scout's birthday. On March 12th in 1912, Juliet Lowe held the first Girl Scout meeting in the United States with 18 girls from Savannah, Georgia. So last Thursday, the Girl Scouts were 103 years old.
Today, Girl Scouts of the USA has more than 3 million girls and adults. Here in Fanwood Scotch Plains, we have 862 girls from kindergarten through high school and more than 400 adult volunteers. Juliet Lowe believed that Girl Scouts should help their communities. During the early years of Girl Scouts during World War I and the Great Depression, Girl Scouts helped in hospitals, collecting clothing, made quilts, and held food drives. We still do many of those things today right here in Fanwood. During Martin Luther King Day of Service this year, Girl Scout troops led projects which made sandwiches for the Salvation Army, pictures to cheer up people in hospitals and nursing homes, and gift boxes for children in need. Girl Scouts regularly help out at the Fanwood Nature Center, entertaining senior citizens at the Chelsea and making holiday gifts for Fanwood's Heart for Humanity. We also send gifts to military troops overseas and help animal shelters.
So we are very happy to be part of the Fanwood community. We would also like to thank our neighbors for ordering more than 48,000 boxes of Girl Scout cookies during our current sale. If you didn't get a chance to order any, look for our cookie sale booths around town in late March and early April. Thank you for the proclamation. We'll keep on working to keep Fanwood a great place to live, and we'll see you in the Memorial Day Parade. And we also have some cookies for the council and the mayor.
Oh, love them. Thank you. Thank you. The girl will be here, where I will get a picture with the Girl Scouts and the cookies.
Can't burn them anywhere.
Great, so I'm gonna take these, I'm gonna put them right about there, and I'll give you the proclamation here. And I guess, girls, what I want you to know is that the things that you are learning through your Girl Scout experience will definitely come in handy as you go on and you become young women and you have families of your own and you decide what careers you want to pursue. These are the skills that is going to carry you for your life. And so I'm so glad that you came here tonight to share this with us. And I'll give this to you, okay? And you can share it with your troop. And thank you very much.
Thank you.
An Audi with the lights are on in the parking lot. Thank you. Okay, so moving on under correspondence, we'll have one piece of correspondence and move as noted. We may have a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, and then we'll move right on to the council reports and we'll turn it over to
appointment.
Oh, I'm sorry, wait, for the Historic Preservation Commission, actually, yeah, we're going to reappoint Jason Benedict
as
a regular member with a term expiring 12/31/2015. Okay, may I have a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
And then we also do have a, I guess a proclamation, because it is Youth Art Month 2015, and I think that the county is also doing a wide range of art, so we'll pass that out to them. And we'll get on to Councilman Levine, the reports.
Yes, thank you, Mayor. Just two reports. The tax collector's monthly report for February. I'll move the report, which shows that in the month of February, we had total collections of
$5,624,536. Okay. May I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
And also, if I can move payment of claims, be it resolved that claims in the amount of $3,341,810 having been listed on the special bill list and recorded in the files of Borough Hall and approved by the chairman of the appropriate committee be paid.
Second. Second, may I have a roll call, please?
Devin Vine?
Yes.
Catherine Mitchell?
Yes.
Devin Morris?
Yes.
Wilson Hugo?
Yes.
Tom Kranz?
Yes.
Jack Molinar?
Yes.
Motion carried.
And that concludes my report.
What are we doing about the budget? Want to say something about where we are with that?
Sure. This is the time of year when we prepare our budget, and our chief financial officer, Fred Thompson, working with Eleanor, has given a budget for this year. And I'm sorry, I don't have a whiskey to share all the details with you. But we are going to have a meeting this Thursday night. I think over in the police conference room. Police department conference room.
Unless it warms up.
Sorry.
Unless it warms up somewhat.
And then we can have it on the carriage house. And the public can attend. And that's where we're going to actually discuss the budget in detail. I expect at this point we are primarily talking about the operating budget. Those are the salaries and expenses and things that go into the borough. And within the next few weeks, we will also be talking about the capital budget. Capital budget is how we finance longer-term projects like roads and improvements to the building. All of that will be done in public. These are just documents now, so you're invited to attend those meetings when we have them. And as we have them, we can share with you the details of what's been included in them.
Okay, thank you. Moving on under public safety, Councilman Morris.
Yes, thank you. Mayor Mara, the biggest thing we would like to talk about on public safety is potential hire of a new officer. Mm-hmm. And Public Safety Committee on the 18th will be interviewing five different candidates. And that is that issue. And if you give me a second, I can also get to the Public Safety Committee, and I apologize. In any case, on Wednesday, Councilman Ross Hugel and Councilwoman Kathy Mitchell and I will be meeting with five candidates, and we will be recommending of those five candidates.
To the mayor and council?
To the mayor and council. Okay. And then also I'll give you the total calls for police assistance were 967 for the month of February 2015. That seems like a lot.
Seems like a lot.
For a short month.
In the winter.
Yes.
In the winter.
All right. Well, total calls for police assistance through 911 were 43.
So what is the rest?
Mm-hmm. All right. Well,
it's 920.
967.
But I mean, what's the difference?
Well, I can break it down for you.
People are calling for 911.
Vehicle stops were 528. Total summonses issued were 357.
Okay.
Total adult arrests were 13. No juvenile arrests. And in Fanwood, there were 10 total crimes reported. Two of fraud, one of criminal mischief, one of disorderly persons, four harassment, one simple assault, and one burglary.
Thank you.
And that is my report.
Thank you. Councilman Hugel, Public Works, please.
Good evening. First of all, I have a lot of stuff to report.
Take your time.
But I didn't hear any thank yous because the last meeting that we had, I declared winter over. And I don't know if you've looked outside, but winter is over. So that's the first thing. And because
it
I was
took you long enough.
Because I was able to do that, I've gotten into the meteorology business. And so tomorrow it's going to be rain showers early, tapering off in the afternoon, be about 55 degrees. As for my report on the fire department, there were 27 calls for assistance to our fire department in February. One of them, as we know, was the Kempshaw fire. That actually occurred on February 2nd. There were four calls for mutual aid. And there were some broken pipes because of the freezing and the thawing. So there were 27 total alarms and two drills done in February. That's the chief's fire department report. Let me see here. Clean Community Day, April 25th, 2015 is Clean Community Day. 8:30 in the morning, don't be late. South side of the train station, as we always do, and you know we always have goodies for everybody. But it's always a nice morning to get out and beautify our lovely town of Fanwood. And I am predicting good weather for that day too. So, public.
Wait a minute, I want to write it down. Please
do.
Please, I will.
I'm confident.
Okay.
The other thing, we had a public works meeting last week. And a lot of stuff going on in Public Works, Mayor. I got an American Water report, okay, because I invited Mike Binge of American Water to come to our meeting, and which he was happy to oblige. I've also invited Mike to come to our next agenda meeting. So I think that's April 6th. So hopefully, I believe Mike said he was available and that he would come and he would give everybody an update. But just so everybody's aware, the Madison Avenue is almost done, it's almost completed. Portland Avenue is 50% done, so there's that. They're scheduled to end there on April 16th, so hopefully all of that will be concluded, resolved, April 16th, and since I'm predicting good weather, I think we're going to meet that day. Then they're going to move along to the southeast side quadrant, where they're going to do some cleaning by LeGrand Avenue, those streets, Shady, Poplar, Laurel, that side of town. They're going to do just as they did last year. They're going to move from the west eastward, and this is only going to be cleaning the pipes. So what they do is they send the machine down the pipes, it scrapes, it cleans all the pipes underneath, and because all the bypasses were already done. So all the service connections were already done last year, so they're just doing the cleaning. And then Mike says they plan to be out of here on June 30th. So that's their target end date. They seem to be pretty firm about that. So hopefully American Water will be able to conclude, but as I said, he'll be here on April 6th and he'll repeat some of that stuff that I just went over. Also in our public works meeting, we're discussing some pedestrian safety, some sidewalks. So we're trying to improve the area by the train station on the north side, crossing North Ave to the other side. We're going to make some bump outs, crosswalk, make it a little bit safer, make some lighting indications for pedestrians so they can safely cross during those times of the year where it gets dark when people get off the train and go to the train. So we're thinking of that. We're also looking at some other areas by LeGrand Park. We're thinking of improving some sidewalks there. So we're going over some areas around the town. They tell me I can't build that many roads, so I'm going to build sidewalks. So we move from one to the other. And I have Director Clint Dixon's report for the month of February. And there's a lot of snow in this report. Clint reports that they did snow removal, clearing, de-icing on February 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, 9th, 10th, 18th, 19th, 23rd, 24th, 25th, and 26th. That was a mouthful. And all that resulted in about 464 man-hours of regular time and 256 man-hours of overtime for snow removal to date. So, but luckily we're all done with that. We put that behind us. Last but not least, and I'm glad this is your favorite part because it means I'm ending.
Pothole report.
The pothole report. It's your favorite time of year. It's pothole season. So we've already started work on the potholes. I know once the snow melts, it reveals some pretty ugly parts, but we're Public Works Department's on top of it. Shielands Crossing, Hetfield Avenue Bridge, Forest Road, Poplar Place, North Avenue. They've already started filling those potholes around the town. They're looking for more. They've only started, so if you see some potholes, you can call the Department of Public Works, but they've only really started the filling program. So that is my report for this evening. There's a lot of stuff going on.
Thank you. One new addition to Clean Communities Day is we're going to actually have an Earth Day poster contest this year.
Are council members allowed to enter?
No, this is going to be through kindergarten through 8th grade, and we're going to have two separate winners, K through 4 and 5 through 8. So it'll be an Earth Day poster contest. The specifics will go up on our website probably in the next day or two, with the posters being due on the 17th of April. And it's really going to be very open-ended, in that we're going to be asking the students to design a poster that shows you or your family helping to protect our local environment. It can be any size, and you can just put a little description of it on the back. So we're looking to introduce that. There'll be prizes for the top poster in the K through 4 and also in the 5 through 8 category. And I think it'll just be a wonderful addition as we continue our 26th annual Clean Communities Day. Now I'll throw it over to Councilman Molinar, who wants to talk to us about land use and creative story.
Thank you. Our land use ordinance, we were hoping to get tonight, we're not going to have it until next month, so we'll be introducing that next month to redo the zoning along South Avenue. I also attended the Public Works meeting. I'm also excited about some of the sidewalks and traffic calming features that we'll hopefully be able to do within the next year, and it'll help us a lot with different areas through town. with Councilman Ugel and Clint and our engineer from T&M. So we're working on that. So looking forward to be able to present that here to everyone. You can see what we're looking to do. Also under me, which I usually don't give reports on, but I figured tonight, building inspection is, I oversee that area. And just to give you an idea, just in the month of February, a lot of people are doing alterations and additions and fixes. And just in the month of February, it was over $800,000 in construction costs that our residents are doing throughout town. So our building office is busy, and they're always busy, and they're usually very good. And if you ever have any issues, always let us know. But for the most part, I never hear anything because I think they just do a really good job. So just so you know, that's one of the services that municipal government does provide for you is construction inspection. And yes, there are fees, but it's an important part of Barrow government. And that's my report tonight.
Thank you very much. Councilman Kranz?
Thanks, Mayor. The Board of Health meeting for February was postponed because of March, rather, was postponed because of weather. It'll be held on April 2nd. At the recreation meeting last month, had a small turnout, but they did have a quorum. They basically, they've appointed a committee to relook at their five-year plan to kind of catch up to where they are in terms of their plans for improvements in the parks going forward. And they spent a lot of time talking about the Easter egg hunt. This year's Easter egg hunt is Saturday, March 28th. 10 a.m. and be there at 10 a.m. because it starts on time and it's over in like 3 seconds. But they're going to have over 1,000 eggs there, lots of prizes, the Easter bunny's there. And for those kids who would like to have a little help decorating their eggs, be craftful. Our craft store and toy store here in town will be offering free help decorating eggs on Tuesday and Wednesday, March 24th and 25th, from 3:30 to 4:30, you can bring your eggs in. They'll help you decorate with markers and stickers and all kinds of cool stuff for free. That is my report.
Thank you. Thank you. And closing us up, Council President Mitchell.
Thank you, Mayor. The seniors report. At the last meeting, I was in lieu of the mayor. I was able to present a proclamation to Laura Testy, who is 100 years old.
Oh, yeah, I saw that.
And when asked what she attributed her longevity to, she said, to keep busy and don't sit in the rocking chair. So anyway, she's sharp as a tack. She ambulates without any kind of assistance, and she's a pretty cool lady. Oh, and I guess it really went through town that we honored her because when I was in the pharmacy, I heard about it. And that was very nice. And then when I was at the ministerium meeting the other day, I heard about it there. So it's nice when we can do things like that. Let me see. The poetry series will resume again tomorrow night. The featured poets will be Chloe Bonham and Susan Limbo. These are both well-published poets. They don't usually have a poetry reading in January, and February's was called off because of the snow. But I'm very happy and excited to report that our poet laureate, Adele Kenny, is publishing a new book. It's called A Lightness, A Thirst, or Nothing at All, and they're going to be having a book launching on April 12th. And it's going to be at Kane University. So I'm very excited for her. Absolutely. The shade tree, let me see. They're kind of assessing what happened to our trees during this past winter. They're making preparations for Arbor Day. As I said, I was at the ministerium meeting, and I don't usually report too much on that, but a couple of things that I just wanted to bring to your attention. The featured speaker was a woman from the Y, and they are starting a new campaign as of April 1st, and it's Advance and Enhance Your Life, and they're starting with the Diabetes Prevention Program, so that they go, and anyone is allowed to take part in these things, so that if you have any of the, even if you're not a diabetic, because it's estimated that there are millions of people in the United States who are pre-diabetic and don't even know it. So they feel that if they can get you headed in the right direction, you will never actually become a diabetic. So there are some good warning signs and symptoms. So if you have any of these, you can, if you want to get into this program, they will sort of guide you on the right track so some of these things don't happen to you. So that's, I thought, was very interesting. Also, Pastor Janke from the Presbyterian Church, also, they are going to have the Fanwood Choir Festival, and that's going to be on May 17th. And this is the proceeds, they have a free will offering, and this money is divided equally between the Fanwood and the Scotch Plains Rescue Squads. And I think last year, how much did they collect?
4,000, I think.
Yeah, so I mean, it's in, so 2,000 for each squad.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and the place is usually packed. And they are looking for singers, so you know, you don't have to be a professional singer. A singer, you just have to want to be able to sing, and they will, you can attend the rehearsals and everything, and they'd be glad to have you.
Hmm.
Yeah, it's usually sounds very, very, it really is. I've gone every year, and it's very nice. Let me see. The Rescue Squad.
It's her birthday. It's her birthday. It's Rescue Squad's birthday, isn't it, Tom?
I'm not sure if that's their real birthday or if that's their Facebook birthday. I think it might be their Facebook birthday.
Is that a difference? Because my birthday.
Well, there wasn't a Facebook in 1948.
Oh, there was.
So.
Okay.
See that?
So they changed it to make it a weekend.
Yeah.
the Rescue Squad, let me see. Unlike the police department, they only had 43 calls.
I guess that's a good thing.
Yes, that's a very good thing. Let me see if I can read my own writing here.
Here, I'll read it for you.
Thank you, Russ. What will I do up tonight? Anyway, there were for basic life support, basic calls, there were 18, advanced life support, 10, and then 6 people refused to go to the hospital, so I mean, so they didn't have any, I guess, life-threatening issues. Unfortunately, they did have 2 pronouncements. There was mutual aid to Scotch Plains 6 times and 1 to Garwood. I don't usually ever remember even putting Garwood.
That's rare that we go. They had a cardiac arrest involved, and they just, the time was such that the closest squad was us.
Well, I'm glad you were there. Let me see. Clocked 124 hours of man and woman power. They also responded to. I can't even read my own writing. The women's health at the Chelsea the other 2 weeks ago for wearing red. Yes, that you had responded to. So all in all, they had a busy month. They had an insufficient crew 2 times. So when you have an insufficient crew, the county.
Either Scotch Plains fills in or the county.
County comes in, yeah. And they had to administer oxygen 10 times, and that's it, Mayor.
Okay, thank you. Before we go into the regular business, I will just make an announcement that this Friday night is the Union County Women of Excellence Dinner Award, and Fanwood actually has not one, but 2 women that are going to be honored tonight, which I think is a really great thing for our small community that we actually have 2 women of excellence. One is Amy Boroff for the Entrepreneurial Award out of the Craftful, and the second is going to Trish Nearing, who is a longtime Fanwood resident who does Hearts for Humanity and is always doing good work for people within our community and outside of our community. So this Friday we will, I think several members of the council will be joining me as we pay tribute to these excellent women. So now moving on, I'd like to have a motion to open the meeting to the public.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
I'd like to call forward any members of the public that wish to discuss anything with us, including anything on the agenda.
No.
Seeing that there isn't anybody, I'd like to have a motion to close the meeting to the public.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
There is no old business, which is always nice. And we have new business, most of which falls under Councilman Levine to move.
Thank you. I'll move by consent resolution items 1, 2, and 3.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
I abstain on item 3.
Now, well, we have a couple of ordinances to introduce. So I introduce ordinance number 1502-5.
S.
And request the title and text be read by the clerk.
An ordinance amending and supplementing Chapter 86, Salaries and Compensation, and Chapter 67, Police Department of the Code of the Borough of Fanwood.
I move that ordinance number 1502-S be adopted on first reading, and if adopted, the clerk advertise the ordinance as required by law, and that the second reading of said ordinance be held at a public hearing at Borough Hall on April 6, 2015 at 7 p.m. or soon thereafter as the matter can be heard.
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
A little bit more. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
So that is just establishing last meeting we established deputy administrator of borough. This is setting a salary range for that position.
Yes.
I'll also move on another ordinance, number 1503R, and request the title and text be read by the clerk.
An ordinance of the Borough of Fanwood, County of Union, and State of New Jersey, amending Section 34-9 of the Fanwood Borough Code regarding length of service awards for eligible active volunteer members of the Fanwood Rescue Squad and Fanwood Fire Department.
I move that ordinance number 1503R be adopted on first reading, and if adopted, that the clerk advertise the ordinance as required by law, and the second reading of said ordinance be held at a public hearing at Borough Hall on April 6, 2015 at 7 p.m. or soon thereafter as the matter can be heard.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
I don't think at the agenda meeting, so is this...
Just correcting the last ordinance.
But the wording is, I just read this for the third time and the wording is confusing. So how did we deal with the 100-point members retroactively? That's my question.
I believe they went back to the date of the last ordinance.
Correct. So it's just dealt with in the last sentence. The everything but the last sentence is the same as presently in the code. And what we did was just add the last sentence, which says any active member who obtains 100 points or more will receive a certain amount of money, which changed.
Which changed, yes.
Deferred contribution for his or her active volunteer status on the fire. Fanwood Rescue Squad or the Fanwood Fire Department and shall receive automatic annual cost of living adjustments in 2015 and each the year thereafter. I tried to follow the language above because for 2014 the award would be the amount that we have in here. In the future you get the cost.
Right, so we're going back to 2014, that's correct.
Correct.
So July 15, 2014, correct.
So anybody who earned 100 points last year essentially.
We'll get what
this,
they were entitled to.
Yes.
Yes.
Right. Thanks. That's what I thought it said.
That's what we did. Okay, thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right.
And that'll happen automatically. That'll happen by magic.
You'll see that there's a resolution here.
It's about to happen magically.
The next one will happen.
The next resolution
magic.
Will make it happen magically.
But that won't cover these 100 points. That'll happen after this ordinance becomes...
I got you. Okay.
Yep. Oh, but this is first reading, yeah. Then we'll have the second reading,
right.
Then we'll have the 20-day stop period, and then it'll become
okay.
So we're in March, April. So by the end of April, beginning of May, it should be done.
Thank you.
And
okay. All right. Next.
On the same subject of the LOSACs, I'll move Resolution 1503-53, which is authorization for length of service award to the Rescue Squad and Fire Department members who qualify.
Second.
Okay, may I have any comment on the resolution?
I'll have to abstain since I'm a beneficiary,
okay.
So I won't be voting.
So we'll have a roll call, please.
Yes. Kevin Levine?
Yes.
Russell Hugo?
Yes.
Kevin Boris?
Yes.
Tom Franz?
Abstain.
Kevin Mitchell?
Yes.
Jack Malone?
Yes.
Motion carried.
Next.
I'll move resolution 150354, temporary emergency appropriation. It always sounds alarming, the emergency appropriation, but that's just the routine way that we do funding prior to passage of a budget.
Okay, may I have a second on that?
Second.
May I have a roll call, please?
Daniel Levine?
Yes.
Russell Hugo?
Yes.
Kevin Boris?
Yes.
Tom Kranz?
Yes.
Catherine Mitchell?
Yes.
Jack Malinow?
Yes.
Motion carried.
And finally, I'll move resolution 150357, which is certain budget transfers. Budget transfers are just moving money from accounts where we have more than we need to those accounts where we are underfunded.
Okay, can I have a second on that?
Second.
Can we have a roll call, please?
Daniel Levine?
Yes.
Russell Hugo?
Yes.
Russ.
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 Yes.
Kevin Boris?
Yes.
Tom Kranz?
Yes.
Catherine Mitchell?
Yes.
Jack Malinow?
Yes.
Motion carried.
I just have one comment. That budget was minus 2 cents.
Minus 2 cents, if I saw that. One of the transfer items, to show how precise we are, was a 2 cent transfer to an underfunded account. I don't know why we bothered, but it was there, yeah. Yes.
That's the balance. Mm-hmm. That's the 2 cents adds up.
It adds up, right.
All right, thank you. Moving on to wrap up our official business, Public Works, Councilman Ugel.
Thank you, Mayor. At this time, I'll move resolution 15-03-55. This is awarding contract to T&M Associates for consulting services on the installation of groundwater monitoring wells.
Second.
Public Works.
Okay, we have a second on that. May I have a roll call?
Russell Hugo?
Yes.
Jack Malinow?
Yes.
Kevin Boris?
Yes.
Tom Kranz?
Yes.
Daniel Levine?
Yes.
Catherine Mitchell?
Yes.
Is motion carried.
How long was this for? How long was this contract for?
For a year, but they're going to put the wells in and then they're going to be able to do the testing that they have to do for the state.
And this will then be done?
Hopefully, nothing will, if it comes out clean, it's good. That'll be it.
I know. Never ending saga with the DEP. Okay, next.
Next, I'll move resolution 15-03-56. There's awarding a contract for landscaping maintenance. For a landscaping contractor, we do this every year because it's that time of the year.
Okay, I'm sorry, I was just reading something else. Okay.
Second.
May I have a second, please?
Second.
And may I have a roll call?
Russell Hugo?
Yes.
Tom Kranz?
Yes.
Kevin Boris?
Yes.
Daniel Levine?
Yes.
Catherine Mitchell?
Yes.
Jack Malinow?
Yes.
Motion carried.
Hey, Ellen, I'd like to see the contract for this one too, because I thought last year when we were doing this, there was money that was put aside to do sort of the back door here.
Yes.
Which
I've told you to think about it.
We never did.
We got the proposal last year, so perhaps maybe we can.
Okay.
Yes, I did. I'll talk to you about that.
Okay, thank you. Okay, that actually ends our regular scheduled business. We will have a motion to open up the meeting to the public. We'll have some council comments, and then we will be going into executive session to discuss a personnel matter. So at this point, I'd like to have a motion to open the meeting to the public.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
I'd like to call for any members of the public that wish to come forward at this time to talk to us about anything that they want to talk to us about. Who's on the environmental commission? Who's the liaison to the environmental commission?
You guys pointing at each other.
Yeah. Just take that and talk to them to talk about it. That's my note.
Joe Nagy, native. In the Oakwood Court. I'm going to talk a little bit about property taxes, nothing too specific. I'll have some comments for a little context, and then I'll have some questions. If you watch the state news, and I do, and occasionally I see the mayor on, I have to remind her she wasn't aware that she was on.
Exactly.
On New Jersey TV. And Star Ledger and News 12, the most popular subject is property taxes. So it might be interesting to indicate where we stand as a community. The average property tax in the state is $7,700, almost $8,000. The highest, anybody want to take a shot at the highest?
$25,000.
What?
I'm eating a Girl Scout cookie. $25,000.
A month? That was $25,000. $126,000.
I know what you said, so I'm going to anticipate. It's a little town, I don't know what the name is.
Alpine, Bergen County?
Bergen County.
Absolutely. 9W.
The second.
What's that?
Number two.
Oh, I know.
Essex.
No.
Essex with $10,500. And the third? Union.
Okay.
County of or city?
County.
County of.
I think he was going by county.
Union County is $9,800. And let's see now, and where does Fanwood stand in Union County? Out of 20 communities? Mayor's writing these down. Want to take a shot at that, Mayor?
No, I want you to just to tell me.
We're sixth with $10,700.
Okay.
So with the highest, and the highest property taxes in the country, we're probably in the top 15%. Yeah, I agree. One of the good indicators are that houses get sold rather quickly.
Yes.
Kids go to market.
Our communities. And a good sign also is when there's property available, because it's not too much property that there's still available, they'll knock down houses. It's a good indication, right? And where there was one, they'll put up two.
Right.
And there's satisfied with the services that are coming, but that's a little perspective. On January 22nd, there was an editorial in the Times, local Times. It read, New Jersey property tax mathematics are wrong with redevelopment. Did anybody from the council happen to read that?
No.
I thought for sure you would.
I've never seen it.
This is the essence of it. Former Mountainside Mayor Bob Vigilante shared with us his wisdom before passing a few years ago. One point he made is the redevelopment of the borough results in property tax increases to the residents, regardless of the increase in ratables to the borough. He explained that an increase in ratables, Union County increases the property tax and the state reduces the school aid, and the school aid is a 15% property tax interest based on the value of the redevelopment. Per New Jersey tax code mathematics, if the town improves its tax base, such as through redevelopment, then its value rises with respect to the town's, thus its share of the county taxes rises correspondingly, and its share of the state-provided school or municipal aid drops. Is there any indication that you've seen in the budgeting that this is happening? How much of our ratables in downtown have come on?
I do know that in this budget, I don't know the effect on the ratables, but relative to tax claims, our equalized valuation did increase more. So we will see, I believe, on the school taxes, we would expect to see somewhat more of a shift towards us than in prior years, because I believe that our equalized ratio this year did improve. But there's noise year to year in that, so I can't assign it to this or to that.
And so far we've got, I guess, Crossings 2 wouldn't be, that was just completed, so that wouldn't be in the calculus, yeah, would it?
No, because they just received their CO last month, and I think in order to book it, they have to be on by October.
Yeah.
I think it is by October of the calendar year, they have to have the CO, so we missed it, so it'll show up next year.
So My estimate is right now we have 82 residential units in with our, you don't have this number, and about 18 retail stores. And we have 16 with the residential that they've putting
yes.
the foundations out for.
Yes.
And the townhouses, will those be 24 townhouses?
It'd be right around that number. We haven't finalized
so
that.
So that'll be a total of 122 residential units and 18.
Yes.
18.
Yep.
So when that comes on, maybe it'll
happen. Well, I think a slightly different tactic. I mean, the argument that you're presenting is that we shouldn't do development and we shouldn't increase ratables because by improving the vitality of the town, we might lose some of our allocations and pay on property taxes. And I would just fundamentally disagree and just say if we're...
I know you're not disagreeing with me, you're disagreeing with me.
Right, with that argument, but just that, I mean, we want to improve the town, we want to improve everybody's ratables, we want to increase the vitality. These are good things to be having. It might be that there are some allocations on school aid formula.
One of the quotes in here was the take away from our state aid, and I personally feel a very strong point of view with that. It's because we have $9.2 billion. That's $1 billion in state aid, and out of $33 billion budget. That is one big number. And of the $9.2 billion in school aid, 31 districts get 63% of that aid. And the 557 other districts get the other 37%. Now, Senator Daugherty, he pushes it, and he's for equalizing state aid. There's almost $8,000 behind every student in state aid. If it was equalized for Fanwood, the reduction to the average taxpayer in Fanwood would be $4,000. $4,000. To give you some idea that how big it is, we get $2.8 million in state aid for 5,500 students. Our Abbott district in the state, one of them, is Elizabeth. For 23,000 students, they get $363 million. That's 30 times what we receive. 30 times what we receive. In addition to that, they get $46 million in lunch aid. That's another $2,000. That's almost enough to put kids to the best schools in the state, in the country. So my point of view would be not that you equalize, but for God's sakes, does it have to be 30 times? Or, and the other issue is, I was listening to the governor, person who's running, he may run for president, I guess his name is Valley, mentioned that too often we focus not on the result, but on the process. Mm-hmm. And rather than focusing on just the amount of money, how about the result? For 25 years, since even the state has taken over, we have not graduated more than 50% of the kids who enter high school in most of these districts. That is a large part because the suburbs are carrying
right.
the load on the school bus.
True.
What am I missing?
True.
You're spot on.
Listen,
that
was
disagree.
Very well. But.
Right.
Yes, thank you.
Numbers tonight.
Yep. Seeing that there is no one else, may I have a motion to close the meeting to the public?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right.
That concludes our meeting for this evening. We'll have some quick comments, and then we're going to be going into executive session to discuss a personnel action, personnel matter, and then we'll be coming out to adjourn.
No further action, sorry.
Yeah, we won't have to take any further action this evening. So, Councilman Molinar?
Yes, I heard some interesting numbers from our Joe Nagy, and with all issues that we can talk about these things, it's a little bit more complicated than just funding. All these school districts, if they got so much money and had such great schools, everyone would be redeveloping, everyone would be moving to these towns. But that is not happening. Many of the reasons why these cities aren't redeveloping, because young families will not move to these towns because the schools are not in good shape. So it's not just the funding, it's poverty, it's a lot of other things that have to do with why schools don't do well, why students don't do well. It's not as just simple as the funding and where it's going and where it's not going. It's much more complicated than just that. So that's just my comment on that. Just like with everything, with transportation funding, the fact that we're not funding that, the fact that we just hope all the problems will go away. We know that we have potholes to fill every year, as Councilman Ugel told us, and it seems that the state doesn't think that we need to fix anything in transportation either. It seems that we're just hoping it will just go away. And the problem is our infrastructure will be going away soon, and then we'll be leaving nothing for the future generations of New Jersey, where the people that lived in New Jersey prior to us built a lot of great infrastructure, and we're filling potholes. So there's a lack of vision everywhere right now because problems are tough. They are hard. The reason why they're hard is because the reason why they still exist is because they are hard to fix. So we need to do something soon. Obviously, Fanwood, this is much bigger than Fanwood. I'm very glad for that because I don't have to do that. But I think we all need to educate ourselves on the full issues and not just look at the funding of how much someone pays versus what I pay, because it is a little bit more complicated than that. That's it.
Good night. That's a tough act to follow. I just want to say that I'm glad that the ice in my driveway is melted, and I want to wish a happy spring to everybody.
Kathy?
Tomorrow's St. Patrick's Day, and everybody's Irish on St. Patrick's Day, so happy St. Patrick's Day, and hope you're eating your corned beef and cabbage and whatever, and drinking your Guinness or whatever, and I wish you all peace.
Council President?
Nope.
You just heard from Council
President.
I think my report was long enough, so I'll just say happy St. Patrick's Day and happy spring. Have a nice evening.
I would like to follow up with the Council President and Councilman Ugel. Happy St. Patrick's Day.
And happy spring. Good night.
Well, that concludes our March meeting. We hope that you all have a safe and fun day tomorrow for St. Patrick's Day. It's unfortunate that the rain came in as it did and really kind of washed out the Union County St. Patrick's Day parade. There were the people along the route, but albeit not as many. A full year goes into planning that wonderful parade, and it really is a great testament to, you know, it's a very strong parade, and so hopefully it'll be a much better weather next year. So with that, we will say good night, and we will see you next month.